the diversity in the human population is so great that even if you test thousands of people, you're going to get things you didn't expect once you start testing millions of people. Mm-hmm.
Today we're talking to Dr. Crystal ThomasWhite, who did her PhD work in the urinary microbiome field, and she's also our scientific advisor here at Live UTI Free. She's currently doing her postdoctoral work at Stanford. Thanks so much for joining us today to answer some questions.
I'm excited.
Excellent. I thought first it might be really good if you could give us a bit of background about how you came to be working in science and women's health.
I've always been very interested in bacteria, microbiology. Did my undergrad in microbiology, and I knew I wanted to do a PhD, but I didn't really know in what. So I decided to kind of focus on things that were more translational. So bench science that then can be brought to the bedside is what translational tends to mean. Mm-hmm. And I ended up at Loyola, where I met my advisor there, Alan, who had just started this brand new project with urogyn department about, well, let's actually prove that urine is or isn't sterile. Let's actually take a look at that. And that snowballed into a 6-year program of looking at all of the different parts of the urinary microbiome and how it associates with a bunch of different diseases. And through that, I ended up working very closely with the urogynecologists at Loyola, and mm-hmm. they are very passionate about women's health. And I learned a lot about the disparities and the unmet medical needs, and it just really gave me this drive to be like, okay, I need to work in this field.
Yeah, and that's lucky for us because there's been a lot of progress in the last 6 years or so from what I can see.
Yeah, there has.
And maybe if we can also talk about, we can preface the questions by explaining a little bit more about science and how this type of research works. And one of the questions that comes up a lot is, what is the difference between in vitro and in vivo research?
Yeah, and I want to kind of apologize early on. There's a lot of, acronyms and jargon that goes into play here. So please catch me if I end up slipping into that.
<I'll try.
laughs> So in vitro versus in vivo literally means in a test tube versus in an organism. So it kind of depends on what field you're in and how you apply these different terms. But for me in microbiology, in vitro is, am I doing something with molecular biology like PCR? Am I going to be able to just take two bacteria and stick them into a test tube and see what happens and measure things? Mm-hmm. Whereas in vivo is, let me look inside of an animal, let me look inside of a human and measure what's going on there. So any work with human samples is in vivo, but also if you have a mouse model or a fly model or, pick your animal model and you're doing manipulations and experiments in there, that's also called in vivo.
Okay. And if something is proven to work in vivo, can the same theory be applied to how it may work in the human body? And if so, why or why not?
Yes and no. So the problem with biology is that complex organisms are in themselves very complex, and we are all very different. So if we just look at the difference between humans and mice, there is a lot of differences, particularly in lab mice. They're very inbred. That makes it good for genetic research, but there's a lot of things going on that we cannot say for sure is actually happening in mm-hmm. the human host. So any in vivo work done in mice, that's a good place to start, but it's probably not the best thing to then say, well, if it worked in mice, it'll work in humans. Mm-hmm. The trick is like, or I guess one of the jokes is all of these things have been shown to cause cancer in mice. Maybe mice just like are predisposed to get cancer.
Right? Yeah. Like, hopefully.
Hopefully. But it is a very useful model for things that we can't test in humans. And so on the flip side, if we look at a lot of these studies that are looking at populations of humans, and I think we're getting a lot of this in the COVID time now, right? The diversity in the human population is so great that even if you test thousands of people, you're going to get things you didn't expect once you start testing millions of people. Mm-hmm. And for any individual person, it's hard to say where you fall on that spectrum. So, mm-hmm. you know, even if we see that in a given population that this bacteria is dominant in healthy individuals, that doesn't mean that if we take another population, that would be the same. Demographics make a difference. Where you live makes a difference. Mm-hmm. What you eat makes a difference, and particularly in the microbiome field. So it gets very, very tricky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very interesting. So people in different countries obviously have totally different makeups in their microbiomes.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. And there's lots of people trying to map specifically the gut microbiome across mm-hmm. the world in different contexts. How's it relate to diet and how much of an urban setting you live in, or and how much antibiotics you get, like it all plays a role.
Mm-hmm. So what are the steps that are usually taken for research to go from the in vitro stage right through to an actual product or pharmaceutical being available?
Again, it kind of depends. So the classic, you take a pill type of medicine, is that it's shown that there is an effect when you put it in a test tube with specific things, and we can measure that effect. We then show that it can happen. What we expect to happen happens in mice, and there's mm-hmm. no side effects in mice, like the mice don't die. And then you do a series of clinical trials first to prove the safety and then the efficacy of the drug. And throughout all of that, there's lots of guidelines that have to be met about standardization, about making sure that the chemical you use hasn't actually changed over time, as well as measuring that there aren't any side effects. Again, I think we're seeing this kind of in the COVID realm right now mm-hmm. with all the vaccines starting to see new side effects pop up or not, depending on how you do the yeah. statistics. Yeah. I think all of that is, I think we're all kind of going through a master course in that right now.
Yeah, everyone does seem to be a lot more aware of the steps involved in taking something to the public. But if a patient did want to apply theory from an in vitro or a mouse study to their own treatment, what are the risks in doing something like that?
That's a great question. And part of the problem in the microbiome world is we simply don't know. There are a lot of bacteria that we consume every day. It's in our foods. We have fermented foods that we eat all the time. And in the US, there's these bacteria that are, they're called GRAS designations, generally recognized as safe. Mm-hmm. And those are ones that have been food products forever. But as we're studying the microbiome, we're starting to find all of these other bacteria and that don't have the GRAS designation. And we know a little bit about what they do, but not everything. Mm-hmm. So in general, when it comes to something like a probiotic, most of the ones on the shelves all the ones on the shelves are not going to hurt you, but they may or may not help. And so if you try to go away from what's commercially available, then you get into this whole world of unknowns. Mm-hmm. We kind of think of it like ecology. So there's some wonderful stories about how you try to get rid of pests. So, you know, they tried to get rid of rats by introducing snakes, and then you had a snake mm-hmm. population. And you tried to get rid of the snakes by, I think it was, you just keep introducing all of these other things to kill off the previous pest. Mm-hmm. And then that ends up taking over. There's these remarkable side effects that can happen when you start messing with ecosystems. Mm-hmm. And the same, if you can think of your gut microbiota or your bladder microbiota, much of the same way. There's a lot of things we know we can tweak without causing side effects, but there's some that we can tweak, and there's something's going to happen we're never going to expect. Now, all of that being said, go ahead and play around with the ones that are on the shelf, right? They aren't going to hurt you. They have been used for very, very long. Like I said, there's just no guarantee that they're going to help.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, that's good to know. I think patients often do try to apply this theory because one of the reasons is that there is just so little research into some of the products that are available. And do you have any insight into why so many natural products have never been to that clinical trial stage?
Yes and no. So the probiotics field obviously differs around the world, and I'm most familiar with the US. Mm-hmm. And in the US, food and drug is overseen by the FDA, Food and Drug Administration, and they're the ones that approve any drugs or pharmaceuticals on the market. Now, like I was saying before, if you have a pill that is made from a chemical, we can be very, very sure that it is made the exact same way every time. Mm-hmm. If you have a bacteria, that is a living organism. And the more you grow it, the more it's going to mutate. So there's absolutely no way we can say with 100% certainty that it will be the exact same thing every single time. Mm-hmm. And the FDA is having a really hard problem with this because they don't really have a way to provide oversight or to regulate a drug that has a risk of mutating. Like, that's just mm-hmm. something they've never had to deal with before. And they don't really know. I don't think anyone, even the scientific community, knows how to do that. So a lot of natural products, they were like, well, fine, we won't go through the FDA route. We'll just go like with the GRAS designation, and the FDA will say, well, it's not going to hurt you, mm-hmm. but you can't make any medical claims about it. You can't say it's going to help. And therefore they don't have to do testing. They don't have to do clinical trials. They just get it on the market and go. And the other part of that is they also don't have to do any regulation. There's no regulatory guidelines. So in the realm of probiotics, I think of it as the Wild West. Some companies are doing it well, and some companies are like, screw it, I can make money, right? Yep. I'm just going to put something out there, say this is what it is. It may or may not even have what it says on the vial in the tablet.
Scary.
Right? So some rules of thumb for probiotics are go with ones that are refrigerated. Mm-hmm. Remember, these are live organisms, and just like lettuce, it's only going to survive for so long, and it will survive better in your fridge than on your counter. Mm-hmm. So go for ones that are refrigerated or are what we call spore formers. So Clostridia and Bacillus tend to be spore formers, so they are shelf stable. And that's a dormant version of the bacteria, mm-hmm. is a spore. And there's a couple websites out there that have been trying to check some of these natural products for quality. Like, okay, it says it has this many billion of this bacteria. Can we culture that many billion of that bacteria back mm-hmm. out? So if you can kind of double check with some of these websites, but they're only so big and the market's huge. So they haven't been able to sample quite a large variety of them yet.
I can imagine.